नमस्ते, यू आर लिसनिंग टू फेल टू विन, रिटन बाय दिनेश पटेल, एयर वॉरियर एंड नरेटेड बाय मिताली पिरंगुटे। चैप्टर वन, फेल टू विन। 100 times यू हैमर अ रॉक एंड इट डजंट क्रैक, बट देन विद अनदर स्ट्रोक द रॉक स्मैशेस टू स्मिदरीन्स। विच स्ट्रोक वुड यू कंसिडर एज योर सक्सेस? The last one which finally broke the rock, or the previous 100 strokes that actually has helped you weakening the rock? Tons of efforts are needed before things become effortless. It takes a lot of effort to make something effortless. As a child, when we first try to learn to ride a bicycle, we repeatedly fail to balance it. We fall, get hit, still we get up and gather our efforts to balance a bicycle, isn't it? All those repeated attempts and practices serve as the key to synchronize our body towards the desired outcome, the final success. In this book of mine, I am to glorify the essence of failure that, as a matter of fact, paves the path to success. In my opinion, failure is more like the steps of that ladder which takes us to success. A survey on successful people has revealed that, on average, they have failed 17 times before they could lick the sweet nectar of success. So where do you stand amidst these 17 failures? Have you finished failing 17 times, or anywhere closer to that mark? If no, don't you worry. You are trading on the right road to success. A successful man was once approached by a young man to inquire about his secret to success, for the latter has been failing. The successful man laughed and advised the young man to double his failures. Another successful man had a piece of different advice. He asked the young man to jump on his opportunities. Confused by this proposal, the young man asked how he would know which one is his opportunity. On this, the successful man said, "There is no such thing. One has to keep on jumping. Are you too confused? The fact is, the path to success is neither straight nor a bed of roses. Hurdles are bound to come as the road blocker. We slip, we make blunders, and we go astray and tag our efforts as a failure. These failures are the steps of the process of making us successful. Be dedicated, be passionate, and enjoy this whole process of endeavor. And at some point in time, you will come to realize that giving your best shot is equally satisfying like success. I was just 17 when I joined the Indian Air Force. My first posting was in Bangalore, quite a far off land from my Gujarati upbringing. The life of the armed forces was pretty different and difficult for me, and living far away from my mother and deprived of home food was like an unsettling wound. The training period was for 15 months and none was allowed to take a leave. At the end of the 6th month, I fell prey to depression. I could no longer be far from my mother. With each passing day, the food served at the mess turned intolerable, and I was almost yelping for my mother's food. Somehow the year passed by. On special grounds, sometimes one could apply for 10 days leave, and apparently I could get one. It was a 2-day trip from Bangalore to my hometown. I had to catch Deccan Express, which would leave Bangalore at 3 p.m. for Bombay. My base camp was in Jalahalli East, which was around 25 kilometers from Bangalore station. As per rule, Air Force police wouldn't allow me to leave the camp before 1:30 p.m. So I had to catch the bus for the station by 1:45, otherwise I would miss the train. At 1:15 p.m. sharp, I was in the guard room. However, the police took some extra minutes to prepare my outpass. By the time I could reach the bus stand, the bus had already left. I could see the bus slowly vanishing out of my sight. No hauling or running could get me into the bus. I asked a man on the road and he advised me to take a bus from the Jalahalli West. It was 2 kilometers from where I was standing. There was no auto. I had to run to catch the other bus at 2:15 p.m. Holding my small handbag, I ran desperately. During our training period, we were trained for a 4-kilometer run every day. It's called Health Run. At that point in time, I thanked the Health Run practice for rescuing me. As I was just a few yards away, I saw that 2:15 bus leaving. I was sweating profusely. I couldn't afford to miss the train. I saw an auto taking a turn and waved at it. The driver said he would drop a passenger and come for me. He did come and also agreed to drop me at the station. My only request was to drive as fast as possible and drop me closest to platform number 6. He agreed. However, the more he raced the engine, slower the auto moved. Wait. Neither he nor I could do anything to it. We reached near the railway crossings and to make things worse, the gate was closed. There was no room for waiting. I had to chalk out some quick plan. I paid my auto driver, crossed the gate on foot and saw another auto on the other side. I requested that the auto's passenger exchange the auto with me and they agreed to help me as well. The second auto scurried and dropped me at platform number 6, where I had to exchange my Air Force ticket warrant at the booking window. Those days, it used to take time for they had to calculate the distance between Bangalore to Vadodara. Impatient, I watched Deccan Express all prepared to leave from platform number 9. Sharp at 3, I got the clearance from the booking window. Just imagine my situation. I had to cross 3 platforms to catch my train. I left the window here and there, the train blew its whistle. I ran crosswise, keeping a firm eye on the train. I crossed the railway tracks and could reach closer to the last bogie. The train was picking up and I kept banging on the compartment gate to open it. It seemed empty as it was the military compartment. 2 men were inside and rejected my request, stating the same. Unfortunately, I was not in my uniform. I had to shout that I was from Air Force. They opened the gate and finally, I could get into my Deccan Express. The 2 men who helped me, one was with the Indian Navy and the other was with the Army. And with me getting in, the compartment had all the 3 forces together. A sheer thread of excitement ran through my thoughts. Considering the hardships I had to bear to catch this train, I was elated and relaxed in chorus. Finally, I would be meeting my mother, my family. I enjoyed my dinner and throughout the night, I felt a kind of joy brewing within. Exhausted, I fell asleep. It was only midnight when I woke up realizing the train was halted. On inquiring, I was told about some engine issue and the train hadn't moved since 2 hours. Dear me, what would I do now? If Deccan Express was delayed by 2 hours, I wouldn't be able to get any train to Vadodara from Bombay. I would have to wait for the next morning trains. All that peaceful sleep of mine was snatched with a flicker. The train reached Bombay by midnight instead of 9 p.m. and I had missed my connecting train. So, couldn't I meet my mother at all? I did meet my mother, but I was late by 12 hours or so. What can we call this? Was I failed or successful? I would like to say that I had failed successfully. The chain of events failed, but I was indeed successful. Consistency is a kingmaker. It is said that Abraham Lincoln had failed 32 times before he became the 16th president of the USA. His failures didn't lend him an added qualification, but his consistency did. He could have left politics after his failed attempts, but then, in that case, none would have known him. History today has encrypted his name with gold. For what? His failures? No, he is known for his consistent efforts. Failure is never a full stop. It is one of the events in your course of success. It is one of the many fragments of life. For Edison, it took more than thousands of experiments before he could light a bulb. What do you think about failed experiments? Was it easy for Edison? Never. But someday, patience and perseverance bear you the sweetest fruit. Failure does demotivate, feeds with frustration and deepens our depressive wounds, and even sucks out life from a creative mind. And there, the question comes, what could it be that doesn't let a man give up? The answer is faith, confidence, self-belief, and a clear picture of mission and vision in life. If we put these factors in Edison's success story, faith, his scientific acumen told him that there can be a combination of metals that would emit light when electricity passes through. Confidence, unless he exhausts all possibilities, he'll continue. Self-belief, he's meant to give some great inventions to this world. Vision, transform lives towards betterment and making history. Mission, it is said that Edison had a pamphlet pasted on his wall which stated, "I want to give the world light through electricity, so cheap that candles will be affordable only for the riches." The mission of this book is to redefine failure in a positive way. It is better to work harder every day without the fear of failing, but with a new zeal to work better.
Manzil milegi to bhatak kar hi sahi. गुमराह वो है जो घर से निकले ही नहीं। एक बार श्री राम और लक्ष्मण के बीच बहस हो गई। श्री राम ने कहा, आदर्श के बिना जीवन व्यर्थ है। लक्ष्मण ने उत्तर दिया, इसी आदर्श के लिए कभी कभी जीवन व्यर्थ हो जाता है। इस टिप्पणी पर श्री राम का जवाब सुनिए। जिस आदर्श के लिए जीवन व्यर्थ हो जाता है, वो भी किसी न किसी के लिए आदर्श बन जाता है।
माय डियर रीडर्स, if you are intrigued by this concept of failing successfully, let me tell you, failing is nothing but an art of learning. Take any business or listen to any of these moguls' talks. The common ingredient in their thought process talks about ethics and values. Set your ethics first. They form the basic foundation of your actions, no matter how small your endeavor is. Your ethics and values pave the path towards success. Ratan Tata has once said,
"Companies kabhi paison se nahi chalti, companies usoolon se chalti hain."
You may fail. Nevertheless, your failures too can leave a mark for what not to do. Turn the pages of our history. There are thousands of failed attempts that have become idols for the youth.
Shahid Bhagat Singh ka maqsad tha azadi, जो वो जान देकर भी नहीं हासिल कर पाए, फिर भी आज वो युवाओं के लिए आदर्श हैं। उनका देश के लिए शहीद होना ही एक प्रेरणा बन गए। देखा जाए तो he had failed successfully। लोकमान्य तिलक को अंडमान निकोबार में आजीवन कारावास की सजा सुनाई जा रही थी। जज साहब ने उनको ब्रिटिश सरकार से माफी मांगने का प्रस्ताव दिया। माफी मांग लेने पर तिलक को महाराष्ट्र में रहने की अनुमति मिल जाएगी। तिलक का जवाब अनोखा था, माफी मांगने से वो महाराष्ट्र भी मेरे लिए अंडमान के कारावास जैसा होगा और ना मांगने से वहां कारावास महाराष्ट्र जैसा होगा।
What do you think of such determination? These freedom fighters had set their vision clear. They knew their target and history reveals how they all were browbeaten by failures. Still, they are great. Their endeavors were great. They might have failed to reach their milestone, but they did contribute in the final outcome. Business tycoon, creator of Wipro, and a great philanthropist, Mr. Azim Premji had four V's for a successful business. V for vision. What will be the repercussions of your actions? One must carry a vision. An action taken today must have a future associated with it. And if you wish to be successful, your vision must be clear and the decisive factor over every action of yours. Vision gives you the direction, and knowing the direction is more important than speed. V. Values. A good life is driven by ethics and values. A principled man only can lead a business to success. Principles decide your boundaries, not against trying anything new, but against everything that doesn't follow your principles. Decision making is always easier when there is no conflict of ideologies and values between the different participants. V. Volume. Your conviction towards your vision and the quality of your products will only decide the volume of your business. V. Victory. Vision plus value plus volume is equal to victory minus success in business. All life, we sit and ponder over how much we have gained and how big is our loss. Let me tell you something very interesting. We fail and we get bogged down by the pain inflicted through that failure. However, if we fail to hold our ethics high, the pain is quite manageable. It is often found that a loss gained ethically is less painful than a success acquired unethically. An unethical success is more like a scar, never getting healed. Talking about a principled life, the best example is Amitabh Bachchan's character in the Bollywood blockbuster Deewar. Remember the famous dialogue?
Main aaj bhi pheke hue paise nahi uthata.
This is all about principles and how devoted one can be towards their chosen ethics.
Yahi soch insaan ko lambi race ka ghoda banati hai.
I believe you have heard about Captain Manoj Kumar. He was the hero of our Kargil war. He had a very famous quote about failure.
Kuch lakshya itne yogya hote hain ki wo asafal hone ke liye bhi shandar hote hain.
Success and failure are two perspectives of our human mind. Citing quotes and deliveries of famous personalities is just a way to make all of you believe that failure is an integral part of anybody's success story. Life is a long game of hurdle race. Some cross the hurdles and win, while some lose. All that matters is your participation. Never fall prey to despair. Never be afraid of losing, but always be afraid of not trying enough. Our actions should be guided by our ethics, but should always be free from the attachments of the outcome. There is a lesson in everything. There is a lesson in each experience. Every failure is a stepping stone to success. Every difficulty or disappointment is a trial of your faith. Every unpleasant or temptation is a test of your inner strength. Swami Sivananda. Life is all about gaining a miasma of experiences. Some will be charming, titillating, while many turn out to be blotch in our otherwise colorful life. In either case, we have to move along and keep delivering our best. The Japanese business tycoon Akio Morita once quoted beautifully, "Working only for profit is more like playing tennis by keeping the eyes on the scoreboard instead of the ball." My life in the Indian Air Force has given me the opportunity to observe failure closely. Today, if I am able to stand still within the bastion of a principled life, I owe that to all my failed attempts. A victory must instill humility, while a failure leaves us with a plethora of lessons to be learned. I was a below average student. When all my friends were planning to do engineering or to become a doctor, I was sitting with a mark sheet of 54%. I couldn't follow those marvelously scoring friends of mine, and neither could I stagger there forever. There were two options available to me. Either I should wear the shoes of geniuses like Einstein, Amitabh Bachchan, or Bill Gates, who had done some extraordinary works, or I should do something very different. Doing something different has its own advantages. No comparison, no scoreboard to hog onto, and believably, no competition. Doing something different always put you out of the box. You tend to learn and unlearn several things at a go, and this process of learning and relearning itself makes you a winner. On the same note, the route to be different is not an easy path to tread upon. The biggest challenge one faces is public opinion about it. No? Once you have deviated from the preferred norm, you are questioned. One needs a constant flow of courage and inspiration to follow a different path. There lingers a constant fear of failing.
लोग क्या कहेंगे?
You feel trapped under a constant watch of people around, as if they all are waiting for pointing out the slightest hitch of failure you face. I am from a small village in Gujarat. When I had told my parents my desire to join Air Force, my mother was the first to object. She started weeping, for there prevails a general impression in our society that whoever joins the armed force are the most vulnerable to death. Here, let me reveal the facts after spending decades with the armed forces. Although there is always a risk factor involved, the facts are quite different. For example, America has lost more than 2.5 lakhs of people in car accidents since the cars were invented, which is more than the lives lost in World War I, World War II, the Vienna War and 16 years of Vietnam War put all together. The biggest challenge in India is, whenever anyone wants to divert from normalcy, the first answer comes as no. When I decided to join the Air Force, friends and relatives from every corner pipelined their concern. My mother was briefed now and then with the cons of being into the armed forces.
ये मर जाएगा, इसको एयर फोर्स में मत भेजना.
That has become the standard dialogue from everyone. Interestingly, a survey says that a child hears around 1.5 lakhs of no's till it reaches the age of 17. Hilarious.
जब एक बच्चा पहली बार माँ बोलता है तो सब ताली बजाते हैं, जब पहली बार पापा बोलता है तो सब खुश हो जाते हैं, पर जब वो पूरी तरह बोलने लगता है तो सब बड़े उसको चुप कराने में लग जाते हैं। बच्चा जब पहली कदम उठाता है तो सब ताली बजाते हैं, पर वही जब दौड़ने कूदने लगे तो सब बड़े उसको मना करने में लग जाते हैं।
Is always trust upon with a big no. I too was subjected to such a big no when I was adamant about joining the Air Force. It was as if every relative of mine was rehearsing the same old line to my mother. My father, on the other hand, was supportive of my decision. He came to my rescue with a unique justification to my mother. See, you have three sons. If at all one dies, you will still have two. There are parents who don't even have one son. The excuse was weird. Still, all that emotional whitewashing did the required job. We could convince my mother to allow me to join the Air Force. Then, what? At the age of 16 and a half years, I joined the esteemed team of the Indian Air Force. I was sent to Air Force Training Center, Jalhalli East, Bangalore. The very first day, as early as 5:30 a.m., we all were made to fall in line. The commander stood in front of us, well-built and around 6 feet tall. He carried a hockey stick in hand, adding to the fear factor for the newcomers. We were 40 candidates, equally curious to know what this terrifying man was up to. Someone from the gathering dared to ask, "Sir, what are we going to do?" Health run. The answer was firm and prompt. How long? 7 kilometers. Terrified by his unhindered response, someone again asked to confirm. Gosh, the commander lost his cool and yelled at all of us.
Sunai nahi deta. 7 kilometer aap sabko daudna hai.
being a Gujarati, I hadn't walked 7 kilometers, leave alone running. All of us as if had fallen from the sky. Yet, none of us had the audacity to disagree or question. Like a lion, he roared, "Come on, run!" And like some escaped animals, all 40 of us ran under his command. I was in a terrible situation. My lungs started screeching out of my ribs by the end of 200 meters. I was about to fall on the ground when I heard a stick thrashing and someone crying out. Seeing the outcome of falling down or stopping, I clutched all my strength and ran. A few meters ahead, again I was about to fall, but then I heard another man yelping and again I ran further. Inherently, I was weak and very much smeared with fear. However, at that moment, it was this fear that kept on making me run. All I wanted was to escape from any thrashing. That day turned out to be cathartic. I realized how one can channel his fear towards strength. With repeated falling and getting up, our ordeal was over after 2 hours. We were hardly awake. The commander made all of us sit at a place and asked the most awkward question. "How do you feel?" Someone from the group replied angrily, "Hell it is." We all were exhausted and then out of the blue, this commander was poking us with such irritable query. "How do you feel?" As if we all were served with some delicious sweets. "But gentlemen, you all had run 7 kilometers. Someone smirked out loud and said, "Sir, we didn't run. That fear of your stick made us run." "Till you ran, isn't it?" the commander replied casually.
आप सब दौड़े हो, याद रखना, चरम सीमा पे पहुंचे बिना आपको कभी अपने सामर्थ्य का अंदाजा नहीं होगा।
5th July 1969 became the turning point for my thinking domain. Commander's one dialogue was enough to bring in the change in my mentality. That morning, I wondered if my friends who joined all those lucrative career paths would ever realize this essential part of life. Perhaps I was the chosen one, for I chose a different path. No? The very first day of my training, I was instilled with the first dose of success. I can. We humans have an immaculate habit of comparing ourselves to others. We often end up undervaluing ourselves. Let me tell you another incident that made me believe how an emergency can instigate the real strength within us. It happened a decade earlier in the US. An old woman and her grandson were alone in the house. The child was happily playing in the garden and the woman was keeping an eye on him through her kitchen window. Little far, there stood a road roller. Everything around, the weather, the situation, were all usual. Nothing to worry about. All of a sudden, a commotion happened and probably left the place with a vibration. The road roller lost its balance and started rolling down. The woman tried to shout to her grandson. However, the little kid was so engrossed with his games that he never heard his grandma calling out. There was absolutely no one in the vicinity to stop the road roller. It was slowly sliding down towards the child. The woman shouted for help, but all in vain. She jumped out of her window and rushed towards the road roller. With all her might, she tried to hold it still, if not pushing it back. The hullabaloo drew the attention of the neighbors and they came for her rescue. In a matter of time, the whole incident became a headline. Journalists jostled to get a glimpse of the 60-year-old lady who could stop a sliding road roller to save her grandson. She had become a celebrity in no time. But instead of basking in the joy, she cried out. She cried because she could never believe in the strength she carried within her. She cried because she realized how she had wasted her life throughout. She cried because she thought she had failed in life by underestimating herself till that very day. Need is the mother of invention. Similarly, I think an emergency kindles our hidden abilities. And as they say, the potential within you is much more than the obstacles around you. Thus, it is imperative and also beneficial for us to butter up our hidden potential. There is no ready-made fit-all formula for success. What works for others may not work for you. Similarly, where others fail to prosper, you may end up succeeding. Every opportunity and outcome of every action remains different for different people. Most importantly, we must acknowledge the fickle nature of success and failure. Once succeeded may not continue to be so, and once failed may not fail the second time. What I advocate here is about developing a positive outlook and a smart working thought process. Your attitude does bring a lot of change in your efforts and turn shape the outcome. None can proceed further with a pessimistic view. You must acknowledge and appreciate your efforts first. Success or failure comes at a later stage. The famous actor, director, and filmmaker of Bollywood, Devanand, has once quoted beautifully.
कामयाबी का जश्न मनाए बिना और नाकामयाबी का मातम मनाए बिना आगे बढ़ने का नाम है जिंदगी.
Very true. Life is like a driving car through traffic. Every day the traffic changes, making it insignificant to chalk out a particular strategy. Some days it will be overcrowded and you may fail to move even an inch, while some days the road will be smooth and you can reach your destination in no time. It is unpredictable to determine the final outcome, whether success or failure. Sachin Tendulkar is like God of cricket. He is the master blaster. But didn't he fail ever? Similar ball, the same ground. In fact, the same bowler. And Tendulkar ended up with a duck. It happens. None can predict the outcome. The only job we are left to do is to perform our best. On the road of life, we have to adjust our way of driving. Traffic is never under our control, but how to drive the car is. In the middle of the sea, when the wind nature changes, we cannot sit and grumble to the wind. Rather, we have to change the sail in favor of the wind. That's all life is about. And that's what is called the winning attitude. So how do you develop this kind of positive thinking, winning attitude, and make it a habit, an integral part of your personality? A study by Harvard Business School revealed that the role of education over which all the dollars are spent is only 15% in shaping the success of one's life. Astonishing, is it not? The same study said that the remaining 85% that actually designs the success story is the attitude. In the words of Swami Vivekananda, failure only reassures that the amount of effort put to succeed was not enough. And one will hone his efforts only when he develops a habit of it. In the last 3 decades of my life, I have attended training programs of the world's renowned trainers and coaches for self-development. I do express my sincere appreciations and gratitude to them, for they have only made me what I am today. Shiv Khera taught me the winning attitude, Harish Bhimani on speaking matters, Marlin Porter on science of selling. Wait, there are some more. Harish Menon on NLP, Dr. Bharat Chandra on personality development, Suresh Mashruwala on self-hypnotism, Mr. Gajanan on leadership, Sneha Desai on power of mind, Mr. Amit Shah on laws of marketing, and so many more and younger trainers. I have read some of the world-class best-selling books which played a great role in transforming me into a positive personality. A few I would like to acknowledge is Think and Grow Rich by Napoleon Hill, a best-selling book for 40 years and more. It is like Gita for many businessmen. Then there is Change Your Life in 7 Days by Paul McKenna, 7 Spiritual Ways of Success by Deepak Chopra, Success Principles by Jack Canfield, and above all, The Secret and You Can Win by Shiv Khera. Each book I read, I went closer to a realization on how ignorant I was, how little I know. Every book helped me to transform my attitude towards my life and upgrade myself to a better level. Have you heard of the famous success triangle? Ask. Attitude, skill, and knowledge. Skill and knowledge we can acquire from any institution, but you may find one thing very amusing. People from the same institution under the same environment and the same teacher perform differently. They all are vastly different in handling life situations. And there comes the attitude, the mindset. In the management world, it is often said that it is 80% of the mindset and 20% of the skill, knowledge, and mechanism. When Reliance Industries crossed 300 crores of turnover, Dhirubhai Ambani was asked the secret of his success. He did not narrate his life story or the hurdles faced. In one sentence, he answered, "I changed the direction of my thoughts, and that changed the direction of my life." The key to success is attitude. How you react to your failures each time often leads to success. Let's assume two men inside the prison. One sees the bars and the other sees the stars. Isn't it about the attitude that you nourish? However thin the slice may be, there are always two sides, positive and negative. To win ahead of a failure, you have to check for the lessons the failure provides. Change the attitude and your world will change.
नजरें बदल डालो तो नजारे बदल जाएंगे, कश्तियां बदलने की जरूरत नहीं। रुख बदल डालो तो किनारे बदल जाएंगे, और अगर सोच बदल डालो तो जमाने बदल जाएंगे।
Behavioral scientists say that the greatest discovery of recent time is not the computers or the satellites or AI, but the discovery about man's capabilities of changing the external environments by changing his internal attitudes. We need to change before the change comes and see the magic in your life. Attitude is the way you give your first reaction to any event, situation, incident, or accident. There is a simple formula. E plus R is equal to O. What is this? This is a simple formula that can drastically change the results of incidents happening in our life, including COVID-19 lockdown and the life after that. Event plus response is equal to outcome. You have no control over the events happening, but you can always change the response you provide to the event. E, Corona lockdown, plus R, depression, is equal to O, job loss or business loss. E, Corona lockdown, plus R, upscaling the skill, improving knowledge, improving fitness, is equal to O, ready for new normal, online new business models and opportunities. We always complain, if I have a few days, I'll do this, do that. We always have excuses for the whole life. This lockdown has given a kind of compulsory opportunity to each and everyone to explore, reinvent, and rediscover ourselves. It invariably became the best time to retrospect. Shiv Khera said, during this lockdown, if you have not improved your knowledge, upscaled your skills, gained fitness, you just have lost a golden opportunity. Have you ever heard of the cockroach theory of management? It's a very interesting analogy.
एक होटल में सब लोग खाना खा रहे थे, काफी भीड़ थी। अचानक कहीं से एक कॉकरोच आकर एक औरत के प्लेट में बैठ गया। डर के मारे वो चिल्लाई। उसकी घबराहट देख आसपास के लोग भी घबरा गए। डर के मारे वो औरत अपनी जगह से उठ गई और हाथ से प्लेट भी गिरा दिया। वो कॉकरोच भी उड़ने लगा, कभी इधर बैठता तो कभी उधर बैठता, एक प्लेट से दूसरी प्लेट में घूमने लग गया। लोगों के बीच एक हड़बड़ी मच गई। तभी वहां एक वेटर आ गया और कॉकरोच उसके ऊपर जा बैठा। उस वेटर का रिस्पॉन्स सबसे अलग था। वो बिल्कुल भी अपनी जगह से हिला नहीं, बिल्कुल चुपचाप खड़ा रहा। सब लोग उसकी ये हरकत देखकर चकित हो गए। थोड़ी देर बाद वेटर ने कॉकरोच को अपने कोट से उठाकर अपने हाथ में भर लिया और खिड़की से फेंक दिया।
This is the cockroach theory in management. E cockroach plus R lady is equal to chaotic. E cockroach plus R waiter is equal to O situation under control. In 2003, after 15 years in the IT business, I was passing through a tremendous financial crisis. Day by day, my debt was piling up. I tried many ways to revive, but things were out of control. The debt was more than 1 crore from the bank and some private finances. Loads of interest was impending. After 17 years of service in the Air Force, I resigned and entered into business. With specialized knowledge and hard work, my company, with mere 20 employees and 4 crore turnover, was a leading and reputed IT company in Vadodara. The loss was piling up and it panicked me. I too had two options to react, like the lady, or to respond like the waiter from the cockroach theory.
मैंने चिंता छोड़कर चिंतन पर ध्यान लगाया। काफी दिन बीत गए, पर मुझे अपनी समस्या का हल नहीं मिला था।
It was 28th December 2003 and Reliance Group of Companies was making an epic move towards the telecom industry. Mukesh Ambani's interview was running on the television. He was asked about the reason behind his move. His reply made an impact on my attitude. He said,
"Dheeru bhai ne hame sikhaya hai, jab naya raasta nikalna ho, to purane raaste se utarna padta hai. Purane raaste mein chalkar naya raasta nahi mil sakta."
His two lines made my day. IT business was no more lucrative than before. The competition was growing with each passing minute and has made the margin shrinking down to the lowest level. My debt and huge interest burden were not allowing me in any way to revive the business. My company was running 20 employees on the payroll. Retail and corporate clients were giving us the business. My balance sheet was looking profitable and from the outside, everything was looking healthy. But only I knew that if I don't take some drastic decision, I will never be able to pay off the ever-building debt. I was thoroughly impressed by Ambani's thoughts. The next day morning, when I went for my morning walk, his words kept swelling up inside my head.
नया रास्ता निकालना हो तो पुराने रास्ते से उतरना पड़ता है। पुराने रास्ते में चलकर नया रास्ता नहीं मिल सकता।
I decided to opt for a new path. I couldn't afford to be in this business. Nevertheless, I decided to wind up only after fulfilling the pending commitments. I decided like the waiter in cockroach theory, calm and cool and well planned. I chalked out that it will take 2 years to wind up with all my commitments to the customers, private lenders and the banks. I was not panicked, but I wanted to go out of business with my goodwill intact and not as bankrupt. Because I always believed
gayi dhan sampatti wapas aa sakti hai, gayi kashti bhi wapas aa sakti hai, par gaye pran aur gayi shaan kabhi wapas nahi aati.
It took me 2 years to wind up the company, clear all debts to the private lenders, and complete all commitment to the customers. I maintained a good relationship with the banks, cooperated with them, sold out all my properties, my car, and cleared everything. I shifted to the rented house. 13th December 2005. I no longer had a permanent address in India. Banks even advertised that I have cleared all their dues. What do you think of this? Did I fail or came out victorious? My debt was more than the value of my properties. Hence, whatever I negotiated, which was about 40 lakhs, the interest portion. This was what I took as an earning to clear the debts. And everything happened because of my honesty, good behavior, and commitment to my customers. Banks gave me good customer certificate, and I even took a motivational workshop on customer service for the employees of the bank. Believe it or not, I failed again. I sold my property more than its value against my debt, proving myself to be a good marketeer. Of course, I was left with nothing, not even a permanent address. But what about I was not left with any debt either? Getting out of more than a crore rupee debt itself was a great relief. I was financially at zero level, but from zero, I could only go upwards. No. The day I vacated my home and office, I opened a diary and wrote, "No one in my family have created such a huge debt, and no one has cleared such a huge debt either. I am thankful to my wife, my daughter, and my friends for being with me. My journey starts again, and I give myself 3 years to rebuild everything. My journey starts now." It took 5 years to build things again. I had a good relation with my bankers even after a huge settlement. They had asked me, "At the age of 52 years, what will you do now? You're left with nothing." I answered in Devanand's style, "There is romance in not having money also." Walt Disney was bankrupt twice at the age of 54. I was just 52 and bankrupt only once. Even after 2 bankruptcies, Walt Disney had approached 36 banks in the USA with the same project of Disneyland. The bank manager of 36th bank first refused him, saying that the project is just a dream, which he had failed twice. No one ever had done anything like it before. Disney replied, "Everything in this world was a dream first. The building in which you are sitting now was a plot first. Someone had a dream and created a building where you are sitting now. Mine is also a dream project. I have approached 36 banks in the USA. There are 150 banks. I have still 114 banks to be approached, and I can assure you that the bank which ultimately accepts my dream project and finances me will one day have so much business from this project that bank will become a leading bank of the USA." The bank manager was so much impressed that they financed him. Rest is history. Disneyland is so big now that if you have to open a franchisee in India, you will need 2,000 acres of land and an investment of 2,000 crore rupees. With this story, even my bank manager was so much impressed that he invited me to give a motivational talk to his bank staff on customer service. One thing I learned that day, you can create a success story of a failure and become a winner again. Don't fear to fail, fear not to try. Worrying is like sitting on a rocking chair. It does make you swing, but never takes you anywhere. Worrying about your problem can never solve it, but channeling out your efforts in a suitable way might solve the problem.
Chinta aur chintan mein bahut fark hai.
Chinta seizes your creativity, while chintan augments and inspires a creative mind. Gather your courage and be calm and composed in your worst phase that churns the essence of success. Once, I was asked how I could be so cheerful with a 1 crore of debt brooding over. There, I had an inspiring story to assist my attitude.
एक आदमी रेलवे गार्ड के इंटरव्यू के लिए गया। उससे पूछा गया कि आप रेलवे ट्रैक पे जा रहे हो और दोनों तरफ से 2 ट्रेन आमने सामने आ रही हैं। आप क्या करोगे? उस आदमी ने जवाब दिया, मैं लाल झंडी दिखाकर दोनों ट्रेन रोक दूंगा। उसके इस उत्तर पर इंटरव्यूअर बोले कि आपको अभी रेलवे गार्ड की नौकरी मिली नहीं है, तो लाल पास कहाँ से आएगी? वो आदमी बोला, मैं शर्ट निकाल कर ड्राइवर को दिखा दूंगा। उसका जवाब सुन इंटरव्यूअर बोला कि ऐसे शर्ट निकालने से ट्रेन नहीं रुकती। आदमी कुछ देर तक सोचकर बोला कि मैं लकड़ी इकट्ठा कर ट्रैक पे आग लगा दूंगा, आग देख के ट्रेन रुक जाएगी। इंटरव्यूअर फिर बोला, दोनों ट्रेन्स बहुत स्पीड से आ रहे हैं, लकड़ी कैसे जलाओगे? आदमी थोड़ी देर चुप रहकर बोला, फिर मैं अपने भाई को बुला लूंगा। इंटरव्यूअर अचंभित होकर पूछा कि भाई क्या करेगा आकर? तो वो आदमी हंसकर बोला कि कुछ नहीं, उसको बोलूंगा कि ऐसा जबरदस्त एक्सीडेंट लाइफ में फिर कभी देखने को ना मिलेगी, आकर देख लो।
Can you believe it? Just imagine his attitude. Till the very last moment, he kept on providing a solution. And when nothing was acceptable, he just found out something to cheer. There will always be situations and circumstances that will go out of our control. The best way to handle such situations is to keep calm and keep moving. Being grumpy over a bad situation doesn't change it. However, being happy in a bad situation just keeps us moving. During a bad phase of life, it is not significant what happens to you, but the most crucial part is what happens in you. The bad phase brings up a change in us. Be positive and accept the change and move on cheerfully. Accepting the circumstances is the first step to move on in life. One of the best examples of laughing at your troubles is a story about George Bernard Shaw. His shows were going bad, putting him into a lot of trouble. One of his friends flew down to meet him. When he reached the show's theater, he found Shaw sitting and laughing. He was curious and asked Shaw how he could be laughing at this bad face. It seems Shaw laughed again and said, "I'm laughing at my troubles."